Hi, my name is Thomas Schmidt from the University of Regensburg in Germany, and I present a short paper titled Towards a Corpus of Historical German Plays with Emotion Annotations. My co-authors are Katrin Dennerlein of the University of Würzburg and Christian Wolf, my supervisor here at the University of Regensburg. First of all, we present results of first annotation studies of a much larger research project, which is entitled Emotions and Drama. In Emotions and Drama, we aim to explore and analyze emotions and related concepts as expressed in text with computational methods. Our use cases are historical German plays from the 17th up until the beginning of the 19th century. And of course, such an endeavor consists of multiple steps like corpus acquisition, development and application of algorithms. However, today we want to solely focus on the task of emotion annotation. In the context of a project, the annotation of plays is not a trivial task. We argue that we differ in some general characteristics from similar projects in NLP. The most important aspect of our project is that we focus on the interest of literary scholars and literary critique, of course, for the intended historical time frame. We adjust annotation schemes, annotation guidelines, and processes accordingly. This leads us to deviate rather strongly from general recommendations in NLP. Furthermore, our annotation schemes and guidelines are developed in an iterative process and are due to constant change based on our experiences and the analysis of the results. What I mean with the point that we focus on literary studies becomes rather clear looking at our annotation scheme. First of all, we define emotion as a term for the state of mind of a character that is expressed through text in our case. And the scheme that we developed to annotate the text with emotions is structured in a hierarchical sense. It consists of 13 sub-emotions that sum up to 6 main classes. And on the highest hierarchical structure, the sub-emotions can be summed up to general valence or polarity, meaning if an emotion is rather negative or positive. The main classes that we defined are the emotions of affections, like, for example, love, the emotions of fear and despair, the emotions of joy, like joy and Schadenfreude, meaning the joy about the misfortune of others, the emotions of suffering, the singular sub-emotion hate, and finally the special category emotional movement, which is used to annotate unspecific emotional arousal and astonishment. The difference to similar emotion annotations in NLP is obvious. Most annotations in NLP are inspired by concepts of psychology. While we do include some concepts that are also known in psychology, we also do include many concepts that are not regarded as emotions in many psychological systems, like, for example, love, friendship, suffering, or compassion. We do include these concepts since they are of great importance for the literary history of the time of our plays, and are of interest for literary studies. So when we talk about emotions, we do not specifically talk about psychologically validated concepts, but rather concepts inspired by literary critique. Another important aspect is that our annotations are intended to be context-dependent, meaning annotators have to take into account the entire content and meaning of a play, and annotators can annotate as much or few text as they feel appropriate for an emotion expression. Furthermore, annotations can even be overlapping. Looking at this example, the annotator annotated two lines as suffering in purple and the end of the second line as love in blue. This whole annotation scheme is of course rather free and unregulated. On the other hand, it is close to the usual annotation behavior of literary scholars. Lastly, inspired from aspect-based sentiment analysis, annotators also annotate the source, meaning the character experiencing or attributing an annotated emotion, and the target, meaning the instance an emotion is directed towards, which then can be a character or a non-character, like an animal or state or event. The following example, first line German, second line in English, annotated with anger. The reference to the source is the speaking character, marked with the pronoun I, while the target is marked with the pronoun him. Yes, and overall we intend to explore emotion and source-target relationships in future studies by annotating these aspects. Now, after multiple pilot studies to explore and adjust the scheme and the process, we conducted a first larger study with 5 representative plays of our overall corpus, including some famous plays also by Goethe and Schiller. Each play is annotated independently from each other by two trained students of literary scholars. And overall, the annotation of one play took around 2 weeks, or in absolute number, 8 to 12 hours. As for the results, I will first focus on emotion distributions. This table lists the sub-emotions followed by some main categories in bold. Overall, we were able to gather over 6,500 annotations. The most frequent main classes are the emotions of suffering with 33% and the emotions of affection. On sub-emotion level, the most frequent annotations are suffering and joy. Overall, we identified negative emotions are way more frequent than positive ones. This is in line with similar annotations on narrative text genres, since conflicts and disputes are the main driver of most narrative art. One problem, however, for later computational approaches next to the general class imbalance is that some emotions like desire or friendship are rarely annotated and can therefore be rarely predicted. We also performed analysis of the annotation lengths. On average, annotators annotated 20 to 31 tokens or words per annotation, which sums up to around 3 sentences in our corpus. However, the annotators do indeed make great use of the varied annotation lengths, since the variance is rather strong, ranging from one word annotations to multiple sentences with more than 300 words per annotation. Looking at similar statistics, considering source target, we gathered over 13,000 annotations. Sources are mostly annotated as characters experiencing emotions and not attributing them. Targets are mostly characters of the play. Only around 20% are non-characters, of which the most frequent ones are the abstract concepts state and event. For concepts that are annotated rarely, considering source target or emotions, we currently do reflect about the benefits of including them in our annotation scheme. One major metric to validate the design of our scheme is the agreement. In the following slide, I will focus on the results for emotions. Due to the variant annotation lengths and the overlapping of annotations, we applied an heuristic to get a first understanding of the agreement. We look at the speeches of each play. A speech is a single utterance of each character. We assign the emotion that is annotated the most per speech, in this case suffering. Then we compare the annotations speech-wise by both annotators, and as you can see in the results, depending on the category, the agreement ranges between 60 to 70% or 0.3 to 0.4 when looking at the Cohen's kappa value. This is regarded as fair or moderate agreement and relatively low compared to other sentiment or emotion annotation projects. However, one has to keep in mind that literary texts are, of course, more due to interpretation. They are more subjective. Other projects with similar text genres do report similar problems. Overall, we do, however, think that with increased training of the annotators and the reduction of complexity in our own annotation scheme, we can achieve higher agreements. So, what are some of the major lessons learned from this preliminary annotation study that we performed? Overall, the feedback of the annotators towards the scheme and also the entire process is well received, since it fits the usual annotation behavior in literary studies. However, the annotations are very challenging and need deeper knowledge of the play and literary history and the language of the time. This shows us that crowdsourcing at the moment is not a viable option. One idea to address the low agreements that we currently explore is to add a subsequent group annotation after the first annotations by the students. This group annotation is performed under the guidance of a literary scholar expert to create a so-called consensus annotation based on the already made annotations. This is, however, time-consuming, and we are at the moment in the process of deciding if this does make sense. So overall, we like to thank you for your attention, and overall we hope you got a good impression of our first annotation studies, and we are looking forward to your questions. Thank you.